Party people, what's going on? This is Samaj Marsh, the founder of BlueDeathValley.com. I want to welcome you back to another episode of Inside the Valley, the podcast that's devoted to relentless coverage of A&T football. Once again, I have two gentlemen who are considered A&T royalty. First off, my former A&T wide receiver and Greensboro native, Doug Brown. Doug with the stunner shades. What's going on, man?
Hey, Aggie Pride, Aggie Pride.
Okay. I see you cooling over there. And of course, the brain.
Just relaxing.
Oh, just relaxing. Oh, I got you. I understand the connection now. So you're just too cool for school, right? Gotcha.
You know it.
you did tell us to relax, and we'll talk about that. But of course, let me also introduce the brains of the operation, the longtime football insider and a beat writer on BlueDeathValley.com. For over two decades, my right-hand man, Craig Turner. What's going on, Craig?
Hey, well, not much. What a difference of the week makes. Come back with that winning attitude. Got back in the win column. Got cool Dougie Brown over there.
I know. Hey, listen. Both of you gentlemen are styling profound. What's up with that sweatshirt, Craig?
Hey, this is an original right here. This is truly old school.
I like that.
This is from 1979, yeah. Man.
So for real? Seriously.
For real. This thing is old as I am.
Okay.
I like that.
That's sharp, man. Even the whole ampersand is a little bit unique. So that's pretty cool. You can't find that in the bookstore right now.
I leave no doubt.
That's
A&T is big.
Hey, that's cold blooded. I like that. All right, so guys, like Doug said, we're in a better mood. Had our first home game in almost 2 years, and guys, I gotta tell you, man, I forgot how fun that is. A&T football is. Yeah. Listen. Obviously, everybody who's watching this podcast has probably been to the stadium. I don't know if some people that from out of town haven't been in a while, but it's as good as advertised. I forgot how electric that atmosphere is, especially for Aggie Eagle. But last Saturday, the sights, the sounds, the aromas, it was all in full effect. Got there a couple hours early because of the new checkpoints they had. And Jeff, first of all, guys, did you have any issues with the new the vaccine policy of getting around the stadium? Did you guys have any problems with that?
No. No problems at all. My wife and I came in came through the drive-through line down at Memorial Stadium.
Mm-hmm.
Got through that without any problem, and got parked and tailgate session and got everything, did our thing, went in through the screeners, went on in, got our seats, no problem.
Right. How about you, Doug? Any issues?
I mean, like Craig said, the whole verification process went seamless, no hiccups at all. I think I got there maybe an hour after the gates opened up, and there were two people in line ahead of me, so cruised through. Showed my passes, showed my verification, my vaccination verification. Went on down, head on down in the stadium. I was in there setting up, 20 minutes after I arrived on campus. So kudos to Carl and those guys, all the folks on campus. I mean, that was an awesome job. Looking forward to this Saturday.
Right. And if you've seen if you saw the podcast last week, the associate athletic director for external affairs, Carl Harrison, he came on the show and he kind of gave us a complete just heads up on what to expect. And I thought it worked like clockwork personally. I mean, I drove in there, showed my little card, went there, went to pick up my credentials and got to the stadium, no issues. It was a pretty good turnout, I thought. I was worried that some of that stuff was going to kind of scare the average fan away, but we had 15,000 fans there. That's pretty damn good for your first home game when you didn't expect how many people were going to go through the whole protocols.
Listen, man, the turnout was phenomenal. Much more than what I expected. I mean, I thought we'd have a good turnout. I knew the Aggies would show out, but we showed out. We showed up in force, and kudos to all the Aggie fans that that came out and supported the team. Big shout out to the student, the student section. Totally caught off guard by the support that those kids gave out there. They were loud, they were proud, just like the university called for. You know, you forget that there's a class of students that hadn't never experienced the Aggie home game. So we had almost two classes of freshman kids and sophomores that were there. And I mean, you heard them from the start. They were loud, they antagonized the opposing team sideline and band and cheerleaders and nephews and nieces and everything else. But, you know, it definitely created a home field advantage for us, man. I'm looking forward to anybody has to come in Aggie Stadium. You know, that was the big question, how things would go this year in the new conference. And that's no longer a question. Our home field advantage may be the best in the conference. We know when we show up to other people's place, we may set your attendance record, but we're going to set some records at home this year, man. And we're going to have some big games, and I think this Saturday is going to be just another exciting electric atmosphere back at over at Aggie Truist Stadium. I don't know the bank that you want to call it. I'm still trying to figure out what I'm going to call the place. It's Aggie Stadium, but Truist Stadium, as long as Truist is paying some bills and doing what they need to do to support the university. We'll give them a little bit of love. But, man, big shout out to the student section, man. Can't say enough about all the Aggies that showed up and did their thing Saturday.
Right. And Craig, so I didn't get a chance to see you during the game. What was your pregame setup like?
A bunch of us went in and did with the AAF, we did a tailgate thing out in front. And so the membership could, so the AAF membership could get a good meal before we went in. Okay. I got there late. I got there about 3 o'clock, and it was no problem about getting in. It took total from the time we got there to the time we parked and started unpacking stuff, it was probably about 30 minutes through the whole process. So, but I can tell you this, we had some Eagles at a tailgate, in our tailgate, came over and were sniffing around and
did you feed them?
People were we gave them some leftovers. And
Craig, don't call any names, man. It's you guys out there that's some undercover Aggies that are catching a lot of heat out there in that social media world. And they asked that we please don't say their names, man. They don't want to make any of their classmates bad, but we'll hold it in our back pocket, man.
Yeah.
But
we know who you are. Yeah. And where you're from.
We had this one guy that came over into the reserve section. Every time we play Central, he shows up in the reserve section talking trash, you know, trying to talk all this. Oh, he was talking all kinds of junk. And he looked at me and said, "What you got to say about it, little brother?" I said, "I ain't worried about it. You be gone by halftime." And sure enough, he packed his bags and he was headed on back across town. So
peace out, man. Yeah.
Aggies took care of business. Aggies took care of it.
Yeah, and look, and had fun, man. I saw a lot of people just having fun, having a party in the stands. I don't know if y'all saw the clips of the
older guy
who was up there.
I saw that.
But the gentleman who was up there, he was repping the band, Aggie Pride, and then the other young person that was up there doing his dance on the steps, man. That's what it's all about. Those are the things I remember growing up, man, and enjoying Aggie Stadium. But I will say it was on another level. It was on another level. It was definitely turned up a notch. So
yeah,
and we'll see how high we can go.
And I felt it early too, because when I got to the stadium, guess what? The first person I saw when I walked into the gates first I went to the back and caught up with one of the Blue Death Valley guys, Trues. His real name is Reggie Truesdale. He's a guy from Durham. He's always in the mix. So I linked up with him, Aggie Monster from the website, and VA Finance. Those guys were there. And we were in the back by the RVs. And I tell you, man, I don't know what these gentlemen do for a living. They might have just invested in some Bitcoin, but they had one of the sickest RV setups you've ever. It's like a spaceship out there, right?
Oh, man.
Yeah, I mean, everything. So I was back there chilling. Then I went to the stadium. And the first person I saw was Lamar Renard, and I saw his dad. And Lamar was kind of like on a scavenger hunt, because he had got word that there was a mural of him and his teammates somewhere inside the stadium. So he was looking around trying to find out. And come to find out that there was actually a whole set of murals that had been installed throughout the whole bowels of both sides of the stadium. showing the track program and various, you know, players on the football team. I think they had one section that's kind of for the 2017 undefeated team. So he was there, and Mac McCain. And I took a picture of it and put it on social media.
It looks great,
That was awesome. Yeah. And
really, you know, we've been calling for that stuff for a long time.
I know.
So it's good to see it, man. It's we're getting there. Good job.
It maximizes the space that we have. I mean, it's perfect. It makes it feel like a real big time college football atmosphere when you walk around and you see your legends and you see the greats right on the walls as you walk through. That's perfect. So kudos to the marketing department. Sure. And I think Carl Harrison and his team has something to do with it, and Kevin Dorsey and all the other photographers.
Gotta shout out Kev.
Yeah. A lot of his pictures end up getting blown up and put to the murals. So that was perfect. So like I say, the sights, the sounds, the aromas, and so much good food and barbecue. But that was on point. But of course, the main thing was the football game. And it wasn't quite the level of my previous t-shirts that I showed off. It wasn't a shutout, but it was still pretty dominant. What was the final score? 37-14. It wasn't even that close. It could have been a 50 burger easy if we would just kind of focus a little bit more. And it could have been a shutout. I think that we had a few busted plays on some third and longs, and they got into the scoring position. And then they had the one long 70-yard touchdown on a drag route in the fourth quarter. But besides that, it was a dominant performance that we were all expecting. Doug, let me start with you, because you told everybody after the Furman and the Duke losses that there was no time to push the panic button. So you have the floor, Doug. Tell me, what was your general assessment of that game last week?
Well, you know, guys, I'm not one to toot my own horn. I mean, it's really not about me. You know, it's not about me. But I have been screaming the Aggie Nation. I have been screaming the Aggie Nation for weeks now to relax. These guys, they are professionals. They get paid to do what they do. Now, they could argue they should get paid a little bit more, but these guys are excellent. They have been in every situation. They've had to bounce back after losing some tough ball games. And they always do. They always come back with a great plan and always have our guys in place ready to go when it's time to roll. So, you know, we talked about, you know, how the first couple games, you know, we had some stumbles, we had some mix up, but we hadn't played in 2 years. So to come back, get those first two games out of our system, have a chance to get back on the practice field, make some adjustments, come out, play your rival, basically dominate them like you do every year. Get back on top, get some things rolling. Man, there's so many pluses that I saw early on that maybe everybody else didn't see. But little things that I saw that let me know, hey, guys, relax. Things will be fine. Aggie's going to do what Aggie's going to do. Let me tell you, this is how I watch the game from now on. Just laid back, sitting at the top of the bleachers, just taking it all in, enjoying the atmosphere, enjoying the play calling. Because let me tell you, nobody works harder than that coaching staff we have on Saturdays. You should take some time and watch those guys coach. Don't just watch the team. Watch those guys work. Watch them communicate. Yeah. Watch how much they give and how much they stay on those guys. And then look how much fun our kids had at home this past game. I thought it was very important to have an early home game, because you allow those guys who don't travel, who normally don't dress on the road, to be on the sideline to support the team. We heard Coach say early on in the week that they were going to bring the energy. And they did. Had no one been in that stadium, they would have performed the same way as they did Saturday, because they brought the energy on the sideline just like Coach promised. Yeah. And, you know, along with what we brought from the stadium and from a fan and atmosphere standpoint, listen, after the first two drives, we were like, this thing is over. All we got to do is go out here and have fun. Yeah. And we saw our young guys who had played in the first couple games fly around. We saw guys who hadn't been out there, like McDaniel and Bo, would come out there and make some plays. So, I mean, we are still climbing. We've yet to reach our potential, and we've only played three games. So, I mean, what do you expect? I mean, we got a quarterback who's still making his first couple starts. So those are the things I look at. Very proud of the guys and their effort. I saw us play good, smart football. Saw us get after it. Saw us dominate an opponent who a lot of folks were high on. in polls and outside of polls and everywhere else.
Yeah.
Down the street, you know, 45 minutes down the street. I think those guys really thought this was their year to get back on track. But, you know, our guys never wavered. Our coaching staff believed in themselves. The team believes in themselves. And if they don't have nobody else believing in them, they always going to believe in themselves and do their thing. So when I see them going that bunker mentality and hunker down, hey, look out whoever the next opponent is, because them guys are going to come out roaring. They did exactly what we hoped they would do. The game was at hand at halftime. You could argue how we got the points, or this, you can nitpick and say this team didn't do this or this position didn't do that. But when you go back and look at it, man, I think we would have had the same result in the end. Guys were out there making plays, having fun. And those games are important early on to get that momentum going at Aggie Stadium.
Yep.
That's why I like to play, open up with that style of game early in the season, man, and get your wheels rolling. And so, hey, we still got some improvements to make. I'm sure Coach has some things he wants to coach up. You know, most folks are pointing to the offside penalties, but I'm not even super mad at those because we were getting off the ball. We were ready to go get my man back there. So, those are correctable mistakes that, you know, Coach will correct. But.
Right. And we'll talk about the things, you know, we'll break down some of the areas of improvement. But Craig, so we had a couple of guys return to action who we were looking for the last couple of weeks. You know, Jermaine McDaniels, word was that he was on a milk carton. Somebody put him on a milk carton on social media. I don't know who did that. I thought that was very inappropriate. But so that was a finally we located. There was a search party. We located Jermaine McDaniels and also Michael Branch made his return. And I thought just the infusion of those new faces on the defensive line was apparent almost immediately. And that was a story to me. Like I had predicted, I thought we were going to control both lines of scrimmages, and we did.
We did.
Yeah, we took away the run. Central's running game was non-existent for much of the ball game. I think their longest run from scrimmage was 16 yards. And getting McDaniel and Branch back really allowed – the other guys to step up, because Robert Porche had a great game.
Yes, he did.
And a lot of that,
and Rob.
Yeah, they were coming with him and Daniel were coming from, if one didn't make the tackle, the other one was. There was complete disruption in their backfield. There was a couple plays in there where Richard just threw the ball down the ground because he didn't want to get hit anymore. The defense came to play. I was real pleased with what I saw out of secondary as well. The young defensive backs that we have are growing up, and they're growing up real fast.
But Craig, Coach Washington did say in this, you know, a couple weeks ago that he felt the best pass defense was a pass rush, you saw that because the quarterback essentially was under constant duress, and you know, I don't know if that was a factor, but it made our secondary look a whole lot better. I can tell you that, because we some of the guys who were blind in the past, Miles Simon, I thought he had a great game. I thought Najee Reams was all over the place making plays. So you know, I think Coach Washington knows what he's talking about a little bit.
and I agree with him, because you know, people were asking, you know, people were ragging on the secondary pretty bad after the Duke game about the getting blistered, but I said then on that show that you cannot expect defensive backs to maintain coverage when a quarterback has 5, 6, 7 seconds to throw and nobody's putting any pressure on him. Hell, I can pick you apart, and I have no arm whatsoever, and I can complete 70% of my passes if nobody's coming after me. So that it makes a huge difference, because when that time is cut and when he's got, you know, when he's got about 2 seconds, and then he's got to start moving out of that pocket or throwing it away. There's only two choices he's got: take off and run, or throw it away. And that's
few times Craig, he did take off and run, they were times when we applied some pressure. And you know, you have to get the kid some credit. Two things I thought he did well: he must have had a hell of a hard count, because he was able to draw some guys off sides a couple times. And he was able to evade some pressure and slide through some holes and make some plays with his feet. So, I mean, for the most part, we kept him contained. You know, like we said, he made a few plays, but Craig, we got after it on defense. We challenged them up front. We did some things on the back end that I was really impressed with. We clouded the picture for him and really got in some windows and took away some passing lanes where he had to hold the ball a little longer. So he was kind of forced to make some plays with his legs. So that tells me two things that, you know, we got our schemes are still in place. Anytime we want to dial something up, dial up some pressure, we can. And anytime we want to adjust coverage or do whatever we want to do on the back end, we can too. So worry ye not, as they say. We're in good position. We got the bodies. We got plenty of depth, plenty of times when we rolled in a whole second unit defensive lineman.
Waves of guys. Almost every dead ball, there were new linemen coming in.
Penalty. Hey, you're coming off the field, coach. Yeah. Next guy comes rolling in, and, you know, two plays later, whenever the coach is ready to send the guy in, he's got another body to throw in. So I've seen us do that with on both sides of the football. So, I mean, that's a luxury that most teams on this level don't have. And, I mean, we're not even 100% healthy yet, so look out.
And I want people to understand, too, you look at the score, you say since we scored 14 points. But one of those was a drive that was extended. It was like third and 17. They threw a little dump-off pass, and this guy literally broke eight bad tackles. And he converted the third and 17 and went down and kicked the field goal. And then the touchdown was just a little, you know, slot, slant, drag route, what have you. And it was a bad angle by, I think, Booker took a bad angle, and he just caught the sideline. I mean, the kid's fast. He's athletic. But if we just have a correct assignment football, that's maybe a first down, if that. And the way Central was going, the longer they had the ball, they were going to end up going backwards at some point. So this wasn't like a team that was ever in danger of winning that game. Central was never in the position after like the halfway mark in the first quarter of really having a chance to win. And I think you would see that in the philosophy they had on defense where they had the two high safety looks. They didn't want to get beat. They didn't want to get embarrassed, okay? I think they would – opinion. I think they went into that game saying, we just don't want to get beat 54 to nothing again. Right.
Yeah.
So we'll let them bleed us to death on the ground as long as it's not big plays, because they stayed the safeties too high and they gave us running lanes. And guys, I think that to our credit, Chris Barnett, our play caller, was patient and he just took what they gave us.
Yeah. It was quite apparent that Central was not going to give up the deep ball very early in the game. But if they wanted to play that game, like you said, with two highs, they want to play that game, we just hand the ball off. I mean, with our offensive line, it was no contest. They did not match up with us physically in any shape or form up front. They just didn't. And
up front,
and when Baker got loose,
third level, we saw that. We saw that when the safety tried to come down on Jalen, and Jalen gave him the get off me to the sideline. And next thing you know, the 12th man had to get out there. Coach had to throw a little chicken wing. That was
I saw
second
that.
Hardest hit on the play. Come on, coach.
That should have been a flag. That should have been.
Come on, coach.
It should have been a flag.
Hey,
it really should
have. Guys,
we'll address that later.
Speaking of offensive line, though, we need to have a camera just focus on Lawrence Legrone the whole game. and we can call it pancake, IHOP cam, something, right? Because he is a bully, and like I have not seen him lose a 1-on-1 battle at that right guard position the whole season.
Like Lawrence Legrone, man, is what I call him. He plays with great effort.
Yes,
fell in love with Lawrence Legrone's film. I guess when he committed and checked him out, man. And just at the time, I just thought we didn't have a guy like that. And he just provided that nasty. And I'm like, man, this guy's going to be, he's going to be tough if he can come up here and play with that kind of nastiness. And he's done it since the day he got on campus. And I think he's kind of rubbed off on some of our young guys, but man, I love watching him play. I'm like you, man, thriller. It's fun watching that guy play, man. He's flying around out there. I got some clips of him just finishing through the whistle. You know, always getting up off the ground, you know, from finishing a play and finishing a guy off. So, hey, man, he's our kind of guy, man.
And like I said, you don't want to telegraph your runs or whatever, but I promise you, if I can't be the offensive coordinator, because everything that we would do would be right. right. It'd just be run behind 60. I don't care what I don't care how the box is stacked on defense. I'm gonna run behind 60 and get my 4 or 5 yards at least on every play. But we in that whole vein, we did have a really great performance with our running game. I think we all had over 250 some yards, and versus Central being held to 52 yards. So you saw the dominance in the running games, but Kashawn Baker had a career performance. He had one touchdown, but what was his numbers? Let me see. He had like
137 is, I think, what the official total came out to be on Monday.
137. And he had a 47-yard touchdown run, which is, I mean, it was nice. He kind of did some zigzag
scamper tackles. Scamper, as they say, a little scamper. Yeah. Oh, man.
He's a 5'6" guy, but he plays so big. I mean, he doesn't realize that he's 5'6" because he's running through the tackles, right? He's running in between the tackles, and he's breaking tackles when he's in open field. I love his burst. I love his elusiveness in open field. He has really solidified that number two change of pace role. Wouldn't you say so, Doug?
And absolutely, man. And when he's out there, I mean, he had a great person to learn from, man. He looks a lot like 2-9, you know, when he's out there, man. Those are some of the things that he's picked up, you know. And I remember when he was a young guy and he was kind of back in the stable running behind 2-9, and it's hard not to pick up some of the things that successful guys do like that. So, you know, I'm not surprised by his success. We saw flashes over the last couple of years. So, I mean, it was just a matter of time before he got those opportunities and those touches. And we see that in some of the other positions, man. It's scary. And I think it's a tribute to how we recruit, how we're able to plug and play, how we're able to go out and look for specific guys that fit specific roles, that have specific qualities and traits, man, and have certain talents. You look on the outside, even with Mr. Bowick out there. He looked like another Elijah I know catching that touchdown pass.
Yeah.
Similar structure, similar frame, similar ability, man. So, but back to Mr. Baker, man. He's electric back there. Offers us that change of pace. I mean, and it still can be a bruiser for you. I think I commented last week how he can run it up the pipe for you, get you 4, 5, 6, 7, just like any other guy that's on the roster. So that's a luxury to have, man. And it keeps teams off guard on defense when they don't really know what your intentions are. And the next thing you know, man, he's hitting you up the gut. Tough to find him back there hiding behind that big offensive line. And next thing you know, he's busting out the back door for 6. So coach is doing a good job of keeping those guys healthy and keeping them fresh. So, you know, I look for him to continue to put the right guys in at the right time and press the right button.
Yeah. Well, bell cow, Jermaine Martin, he still did not have that breakout performance that we're waiting for. We know it's coming. He only had 34 yards on 10 carries. But we found out, Craig, we found out this week at the press conference there was like a mystery because everyone said, you know, he just doesn't look right. What is it? There was never official injury report. But at the press conference this past week, Coach Washington did say that Martin has been battling a ankle injury. So now you say, oh, okay, that makes sense. So he didn't start the season off 100%. And I guess with the missed time in camp, he's been trying to work his way up to form. But I'll tell you this, though, if you watch the film, and say, you know, a lot of fans, they just look at the box score and they say, okay, 34 yards, he must have just been awful. That's not the case. He first of all, he caught the ball a couple of times, and he had some flashes where you saw that burst returning. So, Craig, I'm optimistic.
Right.
I don't know how you feel, but I feel like we are on the cusp of seeing 30 become 30 again.
Jermaine's going to be fine. It's taking him a while to get himself up to speed and really back into playing shape because he did miss a lot of practice time in the preseason. But he's getting there. I know I'm like you. I've listened to all this back and forth with fans talking about, well, what's wrong with him? Well, he's overweight. He's got the big head and all this sort of thing. He's fine. It's just a case that he wasn't ready at the beginning of the season. He's getting there, and right. I wouldn't be surprised that with Robert Morris coming up this week in North Alabama. Next week, you'll see him return back to the style, to the type of player that we know he is. I think he'll be fine. And when he does cut loose, it's probably going to be, the numbers are probably going to be astronomical when he does cut loose.
See, I feel the same way, because right now he's kind of hitting for singles and maybe a double here and there, but he's a home run hitter. It's just like in baseball, you get in a slump, and then once that light turns on, you start hitting like four or five bombs in two games, you know. And I think he's going to get into this week might be the when it comes on, but I think he's going to get into a rhythm where is, you know, first down, boom, 40-yard touchdown run. You know, I think he's going to start hitting those because I see that quickness and that confidence come back.
Once he gets the first one,
yeah,
it's going to avalanche.
It's going to come in bunches.
I see it coming. Once he gets that first one, and he gets that first one, that first really great run out the way, and takes it to the house, then it's like a habit. You know, you'll become addicted to it, and then you'll see him take off. So yeah, it's just a matter of time.
Okay, Doug. So let me ask you. I'm gonna put you on the spot. How many receivers, how many players caught footballs against Central for us?
I mean, that's a good question. I'm going to go, seven?
All right, I was counting. I had to count to make sure. That, you know. So you'll be incorrect. 10. We had 10. Different guys, two running backs, and I guess eight receivers who caught passes.
I didn't count the running backs.
Right.
I'll give you that.
Yeah, so that shows you the plethora of weapons that we have. And like Coach Washington once again alluded to in the press conference, I mean, we can beat you any way we want to, right? Once we start rolling, it's like, you know, 6 million ways to die, choose one. You know, we have the weapons on the outside. We have the backs behind us. We got this big offensive line that's going to push you around and give our quarterback time to dissect. But you mentioned one of the new guys who made a spectacular play in this game, Elijah Bowick. He's a freshman transfer from Virginia Tech. And Craig, I was on the field for most of the game, and I went up right before halftime because I didn't want the March machine to run me over when they was doing their thing. So I went up to the stands, and I sat next to Doug and his beautiful wife and all his family. And Doug, you know, he predicted, he hit me on the leg and said, look here, this is about to be the jump ball right here. And because at the end, we was like, 5 or 6 seconds left? And we didn't set up for a field goal. We went four wide or whatever it was. And Fowler just threw the perfect fade ball. And Elijah, I almost thought it was Elijah Bell the way he went up. Timed it perfectly. And got you know, his whole leg inbounds. I don't even know why they kept looking at the replay. It wasn't even close. If you watch the TV broadcast on ESPN, it wasn't even close. But Doug, I gotta give you kudos. You called that from the stands. You saw that form, something in the formation you saw. But what about these new young guns at receiver who keep making plays every week?
I'm loving it, man. I've said it time and time again. And we talk about the guys on the outside, but the best athletes on the field, man, and it's the best matchup on the field. One-on-one on the outside, you know it. I know it. Jump ball, we best. Yes. I love it. Anytime you give us one receiver a chance to have the ball one-on-one, man, to us, it's playing basketball in the backyard. And if I'm not mistaken, Elijah Bowick has a basketball background as well, man. So,
okay.
I mean, it's just boxing out, just one-on-one. Yeah. Fowler made a heck of a throw. I mean, if you go back and look at the throw, I think he was on the far hash. Flick of the wrist, put in the only spot that his receiver can make a play on it. It just came down to two guys, and I like those eyes with any of the guys on our roster, man, from Banks all the way to Mr. Boat, who introduced himself to the to Aggie Nation at home. So big-time catch, man, big-time call by Coach. We had a couple options there. You know, mine was definitely to throw it, take a shot at the end zone, and see what happens after that. But we took a chance, made a big play. Really, I think it was the turning point in the ball game to really kind of put a foot on Central's throat, man, yep. And
it broke
and deflated those guys. Between that and then them going in at the half and having us bark at them and all the way down through the tunnel, man, and Reynaud and them boys over there, man, I think it just really deflated those guys, man, and I don't think they really could recover from that. And I think it gave us that momentum and that push we needed. We hadn't had a lot of huge big plays like that in timely big plays, and that was a big one, man. It just was, I mean, got everybody going. You really heard how loud the stadium could get, and a big time moment for all the kids, man. I saw the guys cheering Elijah on, so I mean, that's what it's all about, man. We've seen a lot of big plays like that in Aggie Stadium, and it felt like old times again.
And one more, you know, thing before we leave the Central game recap, we do have to give some special praise to our special teams. Because I tell you, man, Central has a dynamic kickoff returner. And I think, Craig, you had earmarked him as somebody to watch and you had to worry about. And we made a couple mistakes of kicking the ball out of bounds, but I know why that happened. We were trying to angle it away from him. But when we did kick it to him, he didn't hurt us. We made sure – and that was like they had a puncher's chance in this game. They weren't going to stay toe-to-toe with us and just beat us for 12 rounds. They had to lay a haymaker, a trick play, a busted play here and there. So I think they, you know, by neutralizing their kicking game, their kick returns, we gave them no hope. And then on the opposite end, Andrew Brown is
– Andrew, my favorite cousin, Brown.
Hey, he is a weapon. I could not believe, guys, that – the transition from Noel Ruiz to replace whoever was going to replace him, I couldn't envision it was going to be this seamless. And
I mean, he's solid. Yeah, I think he's going to break records. He'll break all the records while he's here. If he stays, I mean, why wouldn't he? I mean, he's going to have his opportunities. He's a solid guy, man. And you're right, special teams was solid all across the board. One unit that I have to bring up, you talked about the kicking the ball out of bounds, but after that, man, I thought our kickoff unit was solid. They got a lot of opportunities to kick it off. But there were times, I mean, we know Central's going to be Central. And there were times when, if you go back and look at the film, man, we had a kid that Central did something really nasty to him, man, got his helmet, pushed it all down in the ground, was just really giving the guy the business on the ground, uncalled for after the whistle. And he's a freshman kid, but a kid got up angry for us, man, and had to, rightfully so. I mean, he just being dragged through the mud, you know, referee didn't do anything about it. He's standing right there. So kid was just totally upset. Next thing you know, his teammates are coming and calming him down. Hey, man, don't worry about it. We'll get him next play. The next time the kid had an opportunity to come down the field on the next kickoff, he was the first guy to the ball carrier. And that's the effort that I like to see.
Love it.
They're all young guys for the most part, you know, freshmen, sophomores, and those guys that we were getting experience early on. And now those guys have a chance to fly down on special teams and really become a unit. I don't know if you saw the guys on the sideline before kickoff, but, you know, we had the whole sideline getting the team hyped before kickoff. So when you get those things going, man, and your special teams become scary and them guys take a lot of pride in what they do, I mean, that's what takes your ball club over the top.
And Craig, tell me, what as a coach, it has to be great for you to say anytime I cross the 40-yard line, the other team's 40-yard line, I pretty much have 3 points is waiting for me. You know, just to have that confidence.
Makes a huge difference in your play call selection.
Yes, sir. Too. Yes, sir.
Andrew, and I call him Money Brown from here on. His name is Money. Money
Brown.
His name is Money. Money Brown. Is the kid is unflappable. I just watched him. I watched him in the Furman game, really, and he missed the kick. He had a 47-yard. He missed one. Then he had a bad snap on one. But the kid never – you know, most kickers are temperamental type of guys. You know, they got to go through all this Zen Buddhist crap before they go out and kick a field goal. With him, it's just the opposite. It's a job, and he's like that. I mean, it's automatic. His height that he gets on the ball, the distance is one thing, but the height that he gets the ball, his kickoffs are so high. Codrigan, the return guy for Central, really never had a chance. I mean, it was like a punt. And speaking of punting, Mike Rivers.
Gotta give Mike a shout out.
Mike is booming. I mean, he's booming kicks. And putting them and kept them pinned up for most of the game when flip-flopping the field on them, and made Central have to drive 85, 90 yards on a regular basis. So, yeah, teams are playing.
That's
out
the name of the ball game, folks. That's the name of the ball game.
You can win the kicking game. You can win.
Rivers had three kicks inside the 20. So, I mean, he pinned them deep, made them start from long field, and, you know, that – and. With our defense, I mean, that's just cheating right there, really. We can start
you're
from
right.
the field.
You're right. And speaking of the field, well, I'm not gonna go there.
No, oh, I'm talking to you. We want to get derailed.
No, not tonight.
I mean, I'm not going where you think I'm going with it. I'm not going all the way there.
50, we listen, got 51 pages.
I'm not
going
to turn brown on you. I'm not going to turn brown on you. I do think the field played an advantage for us, guys. I mean, there are not a lot of teams that play on natural surfaces anymore. And I think probably the last time Central touched the natural surface was probably the last time they played in the Aggie Stadium.
Okay.
And if you're not used to playing on our surface, I mean, the stadium, the field still has a nice, decent-sized crown to it. It's got a small sideline. So, I mean, we talked about how the coach kind of gave Jalen – Fowler the flipper there, but if you're not used to coming downhill on that sideline, if you're pulling up because you're scared of falling on the track, I mean, it kind of works in your favor. I mean, you kind of have to be aware of your surroundings. And anytime I played, man, I walked the field, got used to where whatever the field was like. But you know, if you've never been to Aggie Stadium, played on that field, man, it's a tough field to play on. And we're used to practicing on grass. We play on grass, and we're such a fast team, bro. We get going downhill on you. I mean, think about the play the Stucky made out in the flats. When they tried to swing the ball out to the flats, when
he almost killed that dude. Oh my lord!
Man, it's tough to get out of the way, and there were a few instances where they had a guy that was open on a screen pass, and I mean, and his just feet just came out from under him. And if you're not used to kind of making those cuts and being on grass, and you practice on turf every day, hey, that can have a difference on you. Also, you saw a lot of the quarterback struggle passing from the middle of the ball field, from the hash to the wide side of the field.
Yes.
Because that crown often has an effect on you. You're almost throwing downhill. So if you used to play on a flat surface, most of the turf fields these days don't have any kind of crown because they don't need any assistance like draining the field. But if you're throwing off of that crown and not used to kind of getting the ball down, and both teams, just about every team I've seen coming to Aggie Stadium has trouble adjusting to kind of the layout of our ball field. So not an easy place to play. And we also create a home field advantage, but That's something to watch going forward, how teams adjust playing on our home field.
Okay, and if anybody wants to weigh in on there's a debate on BlueDeathValley.com that's been going on for about 4 years now on the grass surface versus artificial turf. You know, they're proponents for both. And so if you want to weigh in there, there's a huge thread. Right now,
I don't know what to call it anymore, man. I don't even know if it's a thread, a conversation, an argument, a debate. I don't know what you can call it anymore. It's a phenomenon.
It's crazy. 50 pages long, and it's probably, you know, it's just getting started. But so basically, we dominate our arch rival. First home game of the year, we improved to 1-2. We're back on the winning stride. I think that we got a great infusion of confidence now. A lot of guys played, pretty much the whole team played in the second half against Central because the game was that much out of reach. But Craig, we're going to start a new little segment on this podcast where you kind of give your own assessments of things, and we're going to call this Craig's List. You see what I did there, Doug? Craig's
I like that. Craig's List. Yeah.
So Craig, you have a list of positives, right, and negatives.
Yeah.
Of how the team has performed up to date in the first three games. So give first of all, start off with your positives. Let's go positives. What's on your list of the top things we've done good?
All right, after seeing these guys play three games, three things stick out of my mind as positives that I didn't really expect before the season to get started. First was our quarterback play. Our quarterback play has been consistent, and that was my biggest concern going into the season was how consistent would a new quarterback who's had some game time last year, but essentially is a first-time starter, and how he would react. And I've been very pleased with both quarterbacks, both with Kingsley Ifedi and Jalen Fowler, in that they managed the game properly. They haven't turned the ball over a whole bunch. We don't have a bunch of interceptions. I think we have the one fumble in the Furman game, but other than that, they played pretty much error-free football in regards to turnovers. So that's the biggest thing, staying away from turnovers, because you usually when you have new quarterbacks, especially inexperienced quarterback, you have a lot of early interceptions and a lot of miscues, and we haven't had that. And so that's number one. Number two, the kicking game. We just touched on with
Andrew Money
with Money kicking field goals and Mike taking care of the punting duties. Our kicking game is a number one first rate. I mean, I'll put it up against anybody I've seen big or small college football this season. That kicking game is awesome.
One second, Doug. Let me ask you this: can you remember another A&T team that had a better kicking game that we have this year, this season?
Kicking game overall.
A punter kicking, and we got some returners too.
There's two folks I have to go to. One person, Yannick the King Matthews, who doubled as punter slash kicker. And you know, he had some big game thing. He had a 5 field goal game against Elon.
Yes, he did.
If I'm not mistaken.
50 yarder in that game. Yep.
Yes, cool guy, man. One of the coolest guys you'll ever meet. So, gotta tip my cap to him. I don't have any video footage or anything to reference other than the stories of the great Spencer Triple Threat Gwynn.
Yes, sir.
Not exactly sure what his numbers are, but man has the strongest handshake that you will ever encounter in life. So Spencer's my guy, and he, of course, he had a great run afterwards. After his playing career as the voice of Aggie football. So
yes, sir.
Shout out to Spencer Gwynn. But with my own two eyes, I've got to give credit to my cousin, Mr. Brown, and the rest of Rivers and the rest of the crew, man. Davis Rogers, I think, got in there and even had a chance to kick off. So
kickoff. And nice, all those nice guys
are talented, man. And they're a unit. I love their cohesiveness. I love how they hang out together. I love the videos, everything they do. So I joke with those guys when I see them, like, hey, man, I'm one of the crew. I'm you guys' biggest fan. You know, you guys are rock stars. So they know it in their own right. So I support those guys. I was a big Ruiz fan. I did have a chance to study these guys' film before they came in too. And I was like, man, we're not going to miss a beat. These guys kick too. So here we are. Sky's the limit, man. And immediately you see those immediate results, how those transition or translate to wins. But we've kicked the ball well in the past, man. Ruiz, after his stumbles early on, which, you know, he was a freshman, so give him some credit.
Right.
But after his early stumbles, man, he was phenomenal. And we won a lot of ball games off putting the ball through the upright. So, you know, I expect that to be the case in the Big South. We're going to continue to make some big strides in the kicking game. And we're getting better week by week. So, I mean, that gives us a chance. We'll have a chance in every ball game anytime you can kick it like that, Craig. Yeah.
All right, so we got quarterback play, and you say the kicking game, right?
Yeah,
so
that's the first kicking game. And I think the third thing has been the emergence of the younger kids on the team. A lot of the redshirt freshmen sat out last year, and some of the new freshmen have come in, and some of the redshirt sophomores. Guys who have been in the background have really stepped up and been asked to step up early because of the COVID situation and injuries, and have performed exceptionally well. So to see those young guys develop so quickly just means we'll be deeper in the bench when we get into really into the heart of conference play, and that's just added depth.
Okay.
Now hold on, Samaj. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention Hall of Famer Monty Key. I don't know if anybody's been
big tall Monty Key.
Watch kicker. I don't know if anybody's been more impressive to watch punter football or to hear punter football. So I at least got to shout out Monty Key too. Sorry, Monty. I didn't forget about you.
And Monty was about 6 foot six. So he,
also played basketball at NC, man. Phenomenal athlete.
Yeah, okay, he led the nation in punting.
Man, I think he actually got a shot with the Jets, if I'm not mistaken.
Really? Okay. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, man. And then, I mean, tall guy, just look impressive kicking the ball, man. I remember Monty when he was at T. So,
We
have some special athletes come through there, man. So, back to 2021, Monty. Man. I had a flashback there, man. Can't forget about those guys, man.
No problem.
Yeah, Monty has the record for the longest punt on record at A&T. I think it was like 79 yards. So
really? So I thought Spencer Gwynn had the record. We got to check that. So he broke that.
He broke that for the longest punt. Longest punt ever. Okay.
Where's Brian Holloway when you need him?
Yeah, I know. We talked to – I ain't call up Brian tonight. In fact, check that. But I believe you. I believe you. Hey, Craig said it. Craig said it's gospel, right? Yeah. So I saw it. You saw it with your own eyes. All right. So listen. Those were your list of the three main positives for this season: the quarterbacks, the kicking game, and the emergence of all these new young guns, and really the young players playing and contributing so early. That's just a credit to the coaching staff. You know, we developed guys like nobody else. That's really everybody talk about doing chicken. That's our secret sauce, you know. That's our 11 herbs and spices. We develop guys like unlike any other program. Let's look at all the guys who didn't have scholarships, any other scholarship offers but us, and they end up got guys who no stars, one stars, whatever, end up going to NFL when they leave A&T. So we have a wonderful growth and development program here. But so, Craig, you know, there have been some things we need to improve on. Give me your list of the top things that we've got to get better at after three games.
Well, first thing that came to mind, penalties. We have far too many penalties.
Yes.
Not the type of penalties. They're not aggression penalties. They're mental mistake penalties. The aggression penalties I can probably live with because guys really trying to follow through on a play. But you know, a lot of the holdings, the jumping on sides, the procedure, the guys not lining up straight, delay of game penalties. We had was at 85 yards in penalties against Central, and that's far too many. You can't really do that against the better ball clubs in the Big South. If you do, you're going to find yourself in trouble. Second thing that I saw, and I would kind of scratch my head, even though we managed to hit the big pass play at the end of the first half. Clock management has got to be better. We did not use a timeout in there. During that last drive with a minute 51, we get the ball back with a minute 51. We allowed almost 20 seconds to run off the clock before we decided to finally call a timeout.
Craig, that's why me and Doug, I was screaming at Doug. I was like, what are we doing? And Doug was like, well, we're going to throw the jump ball here. So calm yourself down. I agree with you. I was like, you know, we need to call timeout. We need to have two more plays here.
It
ended up working out, but I do think we could have handled that a lot better. And
And yeah, I think if we had called a timeout early on, when it went to third down, if we had called a timeout then we could still go with a jump ball, but it would have allowed us time to if we didn't get it, to it wouldn't go to fourth down, because it would have still allowed us another down if we had called timeout, allow us another down to go ahead and put Brown out there to, you know, hit the easy field goal. But that was just, I don't know whether there was a miscommunication between the bots and what was going on the field, or people got caught up in the moment trying to figure out what to run next or what, or what communication problems or what, but we almost blew that. And so that's end of regulation or end of time management has got to be better. And the third thing that I still say, that there's one thing in our defense that I do not like, is the way we attack tunnel screen. For what I've seen through these first three games, we tend to lay off of the tunnel screens as they develop, and then we close once the pass has been thrown. I would like our defensive backs to get a little bit more penetration off that tunnel screen, because you can see it forming normally. You can see it forming with people pulling and then creating an alleyway. Some of our younger defensive backs are just late in their recognition, and we have got to really work on that, because I can tell you right now, the next three teams that we play use that play a lot. And that's really that's usually their predominant call on first and second down, so they can stay out of long yard situations. So we have got to be on our toes and recognize that tunnel screen when they put that man in motion, or they bring that flanker back from the other side. We have got to recognize that and be ready for it.
Well, you know what, Duke, they did that tunnel, that little screen against us. Yeah. To me, it's just that I don't like the way that we are getting off blocks as our cornerbacks. I think we get blocked way too easily by rangy wide receivers, and I want us to fight through that and get into the mix a lot sooner. I remember that was a point of annoyance for me in the Duke game. I thought we did a little bit better job against Central, but when that's their bread and butter play, those screens, we got to recognize it. The first thing is recognizing it. And the second thing is getting past the blocker. And then three, you know, wrapping up, making that tackle right there and there to minimize the damage. But those first two points that you alluded to, the penalties and the clock management, Doug, I'm going to say something you're not going to like. It pains me to say it. Okay,
I'm listening. Do you need an air horn for this?
Not,
or you good?
No, this is not air horn moment. Well, listen, I'm almost resigned to the fact that I don't know if this coaching staff is going to ever cut out the penalties. I hate to say it. I think we're going to be I think we're just going to have to live with being one of the most penalized teams, okay? And so far, we have not got a handle on clock management. It's always been bad. I'm not going to even sugarcoat it. It's always been bad. I don't know how much emphasis they put on. Like, if you continuously do something poorly for like 3 years, year after year after year, at some point, you might just like, I'm not going to prioritize this as something I'm working on, but I'll focus on other things. So that's just my observation. Doug, tell me I'm wrong, but do you see anything differently? Because we've always been penalized from the get-go, ever since, you know, Broadway left. And do I need to tell you about the, you know, Charleston Southern clock management in the games and not knowing that you just need to hand the ball, you know, take a knee? And we've always done things that just kind of it really irks me. So talk with me off the ledge, Doug. Tell me I'm crazy. Well,
I'm thinking back to a few situations. You know, we can point out a few situations and nitpick. Generally, most of those situations ended in a win and a W. So, yes. I mean, sometimes later in the game, you know, there's a lot of emotions. I'm thinking back to the Celebration Bowl, and Renard talked about it. Raynard talked about it when he was on the show. Just looking over to the sidelines, the coach, and coach telling them to take a knee. It's over. We don't have to run any more plays or whatever right. the situation was. So, with winning, you know, there comes some new – there's still new learning experiences. So, I think we had to get to the point where we learned how to win. Learn how to manage the clock. Let's not take for granted that Coach Washington is still considered, was considered at the time a new head coach. I mean, he's 2 years removed from kind of the start of his coaching career. Right. But, you know, a lot of things happen on the sideline, man. If you, I don't know if you've never really been down there or been in the heat of the moment, it's not a calm place. It's more of a chaotic place on the sidelines. And, you know, sometimes as a coach, you may have your headset on. You might have, you know, something going on in front of you with a coach, or a coach talk to you in your ear, which, I mean, that's what coaches do. So, I mean, that's par for the course. But, you know, you learn as a coach, and you learn through experience. And so, like I said, we've had some times when as fans or as critics, you know, we're like, hey, we should have done this or that. Hindsight is 20/20, and even from our vantage points in the stands, and we have some advantages in terms of being able to see the clock and knowing time and situation. But, you know, usually, you know, you have some guys that on the staff, that's their strong point. So as a staff, I know that we have those tools and we have those guys, and we do pay attention to those things, but we're also a high energy staff. So in the heat of the moment, the way certain things may look, we may look in chaos or may look like we're all over the place, and those guys could be communicating in the manner that they normally communicate. And it's not always easy communicating with 18 to 22 year olds either, you know, who are excited about the end of a game or maybe nervous or have some emotions that affect how they perform or how they act or behave at the end of the game. So, you know, as you know, I'm a glass half full guy. But, you know, I think that you'll see some improvement in those areas, or you'll have a better judge of where we are as a coaching staff here in a new conference with new officials. You know, we talked about what those officials may let go or their style of officiating and how tight or how loose they call a game. So let's get the Big South and see, you know, how we adjust and how we coach games and how we officiate it here in a new league. And then we'll make some decisions or make some determinations or evaluations on, you know, how we did performance-wise and how we manage certain clock situations. But hopefully we don't have to manage a bunch of those situations because the games aren't close. I'd love to blow everybody out where time management is watching the clock manage itself, you know. And we've been in those situations. We've been in some tight games where we did put ourselves in position to win the game late. I'm thinking about, you know, a few of the late Celebration Bowls. I think some of the Alcorn games didn't come down to necessarily clock management. It came down to games that got tight in the end that should have been tight. And so sometimes that affects your way of thinking. You know, those are big games. And so, you know, we usually end up on the right side of those things. And like I said, it's easy to critique and go back and look. And even in game, you know, we see the clock, we're up there yelling and we're fussing about things. But we, like I said, we have a different vantage point at times. So, you know, as long as it ends up on the right side of the win column, when it's all zeros on the clock, I'm not going to complain too much, but, you know, I look for us to continue to improve in the area for sure.
All right, so that was Craig's list of good and bad up to date for the first three games. And now we maneuver into our first Big South Conference game ever. We will face Robert Morris. They are 1-1 on the season. Their first game was, I think it was against Davidson maybe. They got canceled because of they had a COVID outbreak in their program. And they were kind of just messed up pretty good internally from a football standpoint for a couple weeks. Then they played Central Michigan, and they got the hell beat out of them, of course. And then they played Howard last, I think maybe 2 weeks ago. Was that last week they played Howard? And that was a close game. I want to say 22 to I'm not going to even insult anybody's intelligence here who's watching this podcast. Robert Morris is not a good football program, okay? They have some sprinkled around talent here and there, but I watched a couple of their games from, you know, everything was on YouTube and some of the recent games was on ESPN Plus. This is going to be a matchup nightmare. In my opinion, it's going to be a matchup nightmare for them. They are walking into a buzzsaw. They can't run with us. They can't jump with us. They damn sure are not going to be matchup physically with us. That's just my take. But let's go ahead and break down this who Robert Morris is, what they bring to the table. Craig, start off, just give us a quick little overview of the what's that mascot, the Colonials or?
Colonials. Yeah, they're an interesting group. They're not a flashy group. They're kind of a grinded out team that wins games by attrition usually. They're kind of like that awkward type of kind of Ken Norton type Muhammad Ali type of matchup that we got this weekend.
Yeah.
Well, Ken Norton had this odd style of fighting and gave Ali all kinds of trouble.
Okay.
And that's kind of where we are right now with Robert Morris. Yeah, you're right. If you're looking straight down the line and comparing position by position, looking at the film for where we play Central versus them playing Howard, you got to scratch your head and say, you know, why am I even playing this game? That would be the first thing that comes to mind. But Robert Morris is a team that can beat you, because what they do is they disguise things very well on defense. And they do a lot of shifting and they disguise and lay back off of coverages. And then they'll come with a blitz. They'll give you a no look and come with a blitz, or they'll fake the blitz, then drop off into a zone underneath coverage and have you throw into the teeth of the coverage. They were fairly effective in doing that against Howard, but then again, you're talking about Howard. Okay.
Yes.
Right, let's look at that. What Jalen Fowler will have to do is he's going to have to be able to recognize, and hopefully Coach Barnett and has sat down with him, and they've gone ahead and looked at the film on these folks and see what their tendencies are, because they do have tendencies. They do certain things in certain situations. And they try to disguise it, but they essentially do the same thing, given certain down and distance situation.
So
offensively, go ahead.
So when you say recognize, you're talking about just read defenses, just understand the fronts and the.
You're gonna have to be able to read where their safety is, because their safety is the guy that their safety leads their team in tackles. Their strong safety leads the team in tackles, and they like to use him like a rover.
Okay.
And he will drop. He will drop into coverage. He will come up to the line. He'll drop off into coverage, and they'll line him up at different places around the field. So where he goes, you can about expect, should expect, that's where the pressure more than likely will come from. They bring their defensive backs a lot to up and run support, because they're not a big team at all. They're not a very big team. So they have to swarm. They use a swarming type of attack on defense. They try to put a lot of people, may give them some problems. When Howard did use the play action, they were successful in moving the ball down the field. When they sat back and stayed in the shotgun formation with straightaway throwing, they got themselves into trouble.
Yeah, right. And Doug, I don't know how much tape you watched of those guys, but they got a quarterback. And I'll say this. If there was like an APB for a quarterback and the police came, they would arrest him. He looks like a quarterback. He fits the description. He's like 6'5", 240, you know, nice athletic build. You know, he's not the fastest guy. He has a pretty nice – he has a big arm. He doesn't have a rocket launcher, right? But he can make most of the throws. So he looks the part, and you know, they have a few receivers, you know, with some quick twitch stuff going on. Their line, when I was watching their film, Doug, their line, they're not going to push you backwards, right? They're not going to blow you off the ball. What they like to do is reach block. And you can, you know, I'm sure you played teams and who did like that. And they try to just get all their guys moving, flowing left to right. And I guess they're trying to just outflank you. So I think our defense is going to have to be ready for that. But Doug, I don't want to be, you see, you're an even keel guy, right? You keep me balanced. I don't want to get too overly optimistic, but you know, I just don't see it, man. Like this, if this is not a 50 burger, if we're not putting 45, 50 points on these guys, I'll be extremely surprised. But you tell me, you know, what did you see from the tape that you watched that we need to worry about? Anything?
I mean, well, they seem to be a well-coached bunch for sure. I look for them to be a cohesive unit. I mean, they seem like they are a tough group. I mean, anytime you get your team out of the Steel City, they definitely exude some of that toughness you would expect from a team like that. And so their play is tough. They'll be gritty. They'll give us all they have. I don't think they have the athletes to match up with us, as you guys kind of stated. But, you know, I expect their best shot. We're new to the Big South, and we definitely know we have that target on our back. So they're going to give us their best shot. They're going to throw the kitchen sink at us. Look for them to try to pick up some of the wrinkles that other teams have thrown at us. Craig, like you said, I'm sure they'll have their set of wrinkles. But, you know, it's football time. This is why we joined the conference, and we're going to line down. And we're going to see how they come and play down a little further south than they're used to coming to play. So it'll be a tough environment, tough atmosphere. And we'll see, you know, how they manage the pressure that we put on them up front. We're going to throw a lot of things at them, too. So we'll look to see. I'm interested to see the matchup. You know, we haven't really played a team that's been from that region recently. So, you know, it'll be new for our guys. But it's one of those situations where I think if we come out and do what we do, you know, it won't matter what the other team does. And I'm sure that's the message that we're preaching to our guys. Hey, it's about us. Let's come out. Let's continue to perfect our craft, get better from week to week. And I think if we continue to show those improvements, you know, you'll see it almost quarter by quarter. Just that we'll get that ball rolling. And, you know, as we matriculate our way through the Big South.
So this is going to be – they play Howard, like I said, in that last game. But this is going to be a new experience for them because they're playing – us here at home. They play Howard at their house. So they didn't get the whole HBCU band. And like I say, it's like you alluded to them again, the Truist Stadium is a different animal that a lot of especially FCS level teams are not accustomed to. You know, when we got the student section like it was last week, we got the band jumping.
Just the PA system just gonna be rocking this weekend.
Oh, it's back, right? We fixed that, right?
Yeah. No doubt.
We bought some batteries for that, right? We got that working now.
That's a bold prediction for you. First bold prediction. Oh, PA system will be working.
Okay, give me the air horn. But you got to start off right now. Okay, all right.
Bold prediction.
It's the
PA system will be rocking on Saturday. All right.
And look, I was on the field level for most of the game, so I couldn't hear anything. But I was just I could hear the players more so than I could hear the stands. But I heard that was an issue, that it was not crystal clear for most of the game with the announcements and everything. And that's a shame too, because like we had Mr. Al Barnett on our show last week, and him and nine other former Aggies got honored on the field as part of the new Hall of Fame class. And so I think that some of their introductions were not really heard well by the crowd. So that's a shame, but I'm not sure what the issue was. Somebody said it might've been a blown amp or something, but Doug is confident right now that will be fixed and eradicated. We'll have all that working perfectly on Saturday.
I'm pretty confident, man. You take for granted how much those things affect, like, the in-game flow, and the atmosphere, you know, not having that, you know, the play-by-play is clear. Even not having, you know, the blue and gold marching machines announcer, Mr. Darrell, you know, Darrell can't do his thing, you know, if he can't get out there and get the crowd hype. And that's, you know, that's one of the times the stadium gets the loudest when Daryl Lewis gets on there and says, "All right, Aggie fans, loud and proud, whatever, you know, can I get an Aggie pride or on your feet," you know, those sorts of things. So those are advantages for us, and those all play into, you know, the atmosphere at Aggie Stadium. So we got to be hitting on all cylinders. I know that folks have been griping, but those we expect to be number one. We set the high expectations. So I'm not worried. We'll get that taken care of as long as it's ready to go by Saturday. You know, let's go. Let's get it together. Let's roll.
All right, well, since I got you in that vein, give me one more bold prediction. Tell me something that's going to happen on Saturday that you want to call your shot on.
Another bold prediction. Blue Death defense gets in the end zone for the first time this season. I know we scored the special teams touchdown Saturday. I look for the Blue Death to get their first score, you know, of the year. I mean, we've had years where it seemed like the defense was scoring almost every game or making a big play every game, and they're making their plays. Man, we're just a bounce away here and there, but we're going to continue to create some turnovers. But we'll get that ball out, and the Blue Death defense is going to get in the end zone for the first time.
I like that.
Hey, first.
And it might be your mentee, you know, DJ Crossing. Coach Washington, he kind of hinted that there's a good chance that we will see Crossing make his triumphant return since that terrible injury he saw in the season opener. He's been in the concussion protocol since. And I know he was out on the sideline on Saturday, wearing the shades, make sure, you know, everything was still right. And I'm not sure what his practice schedule has been like the last couple of weeks, but Coach Washington did say, knock on wood, that he expected DJ Crossing to be back. So with him and Amir on both sides of the at both corners, I tell you, that's going to be a nasty defense. So I can really see that happen. I can see one of those guys stepping in front of a lazy pass, taking it back. I definitely can.
Yeah.
With Doug, help me out. I need an air horn now. I got a bold prediction. That's it. All right. I love it. All right. So here's my bold prediction, Craig.
Okay.
30 will go for 150.
150, okay. I like
Jermaine Martin, okay. Finally hit his stride in some of those holes that kind of closed a little bit in the first three games. I think we're going to be a little bit wider against Robert Morris. And I think once he gets to that second level, he's been gradually building up his speed. I think that burst is going to kick in. We're gonna finally put that Mercedes, that Ferrari in the sixth gear. I think he's gonna take one to the house from long distance. I think overall he's gonna have over 150 yards. So that's my bold prediction on Saturday. Mm. He will get back to his old self. Nice rushing performance.
I like it.
Yeah. Hey, Craig, you jump in the fun now, Craig. You give us one. you give us a bold prediction.
Jalen Fowler has a career day. Hits four touchdown passes in this game come Saturday. He becomes the quarterback everybody's expecting him to be. Four touchdowns. This is coming out party this coming week.
Doug, hit us up, man. We need that. That's really bold.
Four.
And that's awesome. I can't wait. And that's my guy. You know, I love Jalen. So.
Oh, yeah.
And last week, that was his first career win as a starter. And I think people didn't really realize that, but he got his first career win as a starter. He's been in the program for a while, but it's the first time as the main guy. And finally got
the W. He's getting better. Yeah, he's getting better every week. Right. I saw some of his deliveries, and they were just like pinpoint accurate and throwing it in tight. And tight seams between defenders. This weekend will force him a chance to really show what he can do. So yeah, I like Jalen Fowler having a big day on Saturday.
Yeah, and I think overall this is going to be a showcase event for the whole roster and the coaching staff. I think, you know, we're going to have some fun at Aggie Stadium. Hopefully the crowd that we had against Central, a lot of those students especially, hope they come back out. It's a 1 o'clock kickoff. It's a lot earlier. And, you know, we don't have opposing teams marching band to hype, you know, to, it's not going to be a battle of bands probably. This is going to be, it's going to be an all Aggie driven atmosphere. But I think we can hold our own and hold serve, so to speak. I just love the atmosphere we have now at Truist Stadium. So, so much energy. And I like I said, I'm looking forward to it. But so guys, you know what? Any other thoughts that you guys want to put out there before we wrap this up?
Hey, I just want to encourage Aggie Nation to stay supportive, stay behind the guys, stay behind the team. Football is a long season, and the guys need all your support they can get. So do the coaches. So get a guy your support. Show up as safely as possible. Yell, scream, be a true fan. Eat, tailgate, take in the whole experience. One thing that I didn't do before these 2 years is just, you know, take it all in and not take it for granted. You know, we had to take this break due to COVID. We're back now, so don't get too excited. Don't get all wound up. You know, enjoy yourself. You know, life's too short. Get out there, enjoy yourself, be a fan, enjoy your family, and go Aggies.
Gotcha. Craig, anything? Any last thoughts?
Just that for folks who didn't make it out last week to the Central game because you were concerned about the COVID situation, I can tell you that Truist Stadium, I'm old school. Yeah. It's going to be Aggie Stadium till I die. But Truist Stadium was probably the safest I felt being out in public in 2 years. With the mandatory COVID vaccination and negative PCR test requirement, I felt comfortable. I wasn't going there fearing that, you know, is this guy over here going to breathe on me or anything like that.
Yeah.
It was about as close to normal as you could possibly get. So as the game wore on, everybody had masks on when they first got there. As the game wore on and people got relaxed, I saw the masks started dropping. People started to, you know, have normal conversations. So, it's been a week now, so I haven't dropped dead. I don't think anybody else has dropped dead from being out there last Saturday night. So I urge all fans, everybody who loves Aggie football, or just want to get out in the house for what's going to be a beautiful Saturday afternoon from the weather forecast. No better place to spend it than that at A&T.
Yeah. So yeah, check in on that. Actually, I think it's still community day, so there might be some ticket packages to where if you get some group buy group tickets, it might be a little discount for you. You can look into go to ncantaggies.com for more information on that. But yo, guys, we got a one game winning streak, right? We have a chance to get to 500 this week. I expect us to. I think we're gonna play well. Looking forward to it. But, you know, until next time, guys, for Doug Brown and Craig Turner, I am Samaj Marsh. And this has been Inside the Valley. And guess what? We'll see you next week.